Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your most favorite brother from another mother. Hope you guys are all doing all right. Praise God. I'm just praising the Lord, giving him all the glory, all the honor, hallelujah, to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the Most High God, El Elyon in Hebrew, hallelujah, blessed be his holy name, hallelujah, praise his name, brothers and sisters. The Lord's just been showing me so many things, brothers and sisters. I don't know what to say, but you know, one of the things the Lord's been showing me is about those crowns, you know. And I want to read one here to you about the crowns you get in heaven. Let me just read a list of the crowns to you here real quick while I'm thinking about it. First, there's the incorruptible crown. That's for those who run the race patiently. The crown of rejoicing. That's the soul winner's crown for winning people to Christ. The crown of life. It's a martyr's crown. The crown of righteousness. 2 Timothy 4:8. That's for those who love the appearing of Christ. And the crown of glory, that's for pastors, missionaries, Sunday school teachers, people that have faithfully fed the flock of God, the crown of glory, 1 Peter chapter 5. I just want to say, since I already started that, the incorruptible crown, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, 24 and 25, the crown of rejoicing, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 19 and 20, the crown of life, James 1, 12 and Revelation 2. 8 through 11. Praise God. By the grace of God, none of us who are watching this video will have to get the martyr's crown. By the grace of God, none of us will have to receive the martyr's crown. Hallelujah, because we'll be with the Lord before it comes to that, brothers and sisters. 2 Timothy chapter 4. You know, I did a teaching on this about a week ago that was probably just one of the most awesome videos that I did to me about how Paul said he kept the faith. And 2 Timothy chapter 4. Before the Apostle Paul was executed, he had his head chopped off, kind of like what's going to happen to people during the tribulation who refuse to take the mark. There in Rome, as I mentioned before, the Apostle Paul was actually released after his first time in Rome. Then he traveled, and the historians say, and tradition says that he went to Spain for a few years and did evangelism there like he said he wanted to do. And Romans, and then he was rearrested again later on under a different Caesar, another emperor, and then he was killed, had his head chopped off. So before the Apostle Paul was to be executed, he wrote this letter, 2 Timothy chapter 4, 2 Timothy. But in chapter 4 he said, I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead as it appearing in his kingdom. You know, a lot of the new generation, even people my age, they do not use the King James. That's what's one thing that's caused lots of confusion in the church, brothers and sisters. All these people with all these different translations. And when people have all these different translations, the most important thing that it does for the enemy is it casts doubt on the meaning of the Word of God and causes disunity among the brethren. But the King James word quick means alive. Let's see. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant, in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. And by the grace of God, brothers and sisters, all people in the ministry is supposed to be doing that. And whenever I, you know, run into lots of knuckleheads, especially like on YouTube and social media, I always remember this verse. To be instant in season, out of season, and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Verse 3, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Hey, we're there. But after their own lust, they shall heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. You know, brothers and sisters, I just posted to Facebook. You know, I've got the Facebook group for Joshua's ministry where I post pictures of the orphans and the feeding programs and all that. The work of Joshua's ministries in the Philippines. But on my regular Facebook, I post articles, you know, that I see that are relevant to the end times and etc. I just posted one yesterday about Joel Osteen. He just came out with a new book called, you know, Being the Best I Am. You know, he's got the capital I Am. And then there's a sermon on there of him talking about, you know, I am this and that, proclaiming. And it's the YouTube channel is the OWN, which is the Oprah Winfrey Network. And of course, any people who have been following this, you know, Oprah Winfrey says, you know, we are gods. It's like Shirley MacLaine and all those other people, and that's what it's going to. So when I read that Bible verse, Joel Osteen is probably one of the greatest examples I can think of, because that's the largest church in America, brothers and sisters, is Joel Osteen's church. For a reason, because these people have heaped unto themselves, as the Apostle Paul prophesied here, for they shall turn away their ears from the truth. This is 2 Timothy 4:4. They shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Or verse 3, I'll read that again. For the time shall come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth. That's why people who have preaching in churches, and even on YouTube, the churches that are preaching hardcore truth, the mega churches are not doing that because it's about growing their own kingdom in a popularity contest. You know, Noah had no converts, only himself and his wife, his three sons and their three wives. So only 8 people got on the ark after he preached righteousness. They say 120 years. Okay. The Bible says they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. In other words, you know, prove your ministry. Like Paul had said in another place, he said, you know, to the church, I think it was in 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians, he said, you know, you are the proof of my apostleship. I don't need approval from those people who think they're somebody in Jerusalem, you know, and even call them the super apostles. You know, these people that are think to be that they're somebody. You know, to me, I don't know, but they're supposed to be somebody. He talked about the other apostles and even those elders in Jerusalem and all those things. And he said, the proof of my apostleship is you. All the churches I planted in the place where there was no Christianity. You know, so that's the proof of his apostleship. So he tells Timothy, you know, make full proof of thy ministry. In other words, do the work of an evangelist. Win people to the Lord. Plant churches. You know, ordain. Be instant in season, out of season. And all those things that he charged young Timothy to do. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. So that's what I want you to ask yourself. You know, there are so many people that, I won't say pressure, but encourage and egg on, you know, for us to try to figure out the day of the rapture and set the day of the rapture. And people who can hear from the Lord are egged on by people, not always people that can't, you know, that aren't in, you know, into that, into the prophetic. A lot of people who are not in the prophetic, they want to, you know, egg on people and encourage and push people to try to get a date from the Lord and all this kind of stuff. And I've said since I've ever made my channel, brothers and sisters, no man knows the day or the hour. And many people think that's an illusion with an allusion to the Feast of Trumpets with the real name, you know, in Hebrew, Yom Terah. A lot of people call it Rosh Hashanah. I just want to say this, that's something that the rabbinical Pharisees, the Pharisees who are as rabbinical Judaism, changed that. Just FYI for you. Rosh Hashanah means head of the year. But if you read in your Bible and you go look, you'll see that the Feast of Trumpets is in the 7th month, the first day of the 7th month. So Rosh Hashanah means the head of the year, the beginning of the year. So the 7th month is not the beginning of the year. The first month is the beginning of the year, which is actually before Passover. So the real Rosh Hashanah in Hebrew, the beginning of the Jewish year, is before Passover in the spring, like in March, and on our calendar. And then they moved it and just started calling Yom Terah the Feast of Trumpets. They started calling it the head of the year, Rosh Hashanah, which it's not. This is another example of those who want to, because I'm not a person who follows those Mohadim, those appointed feasts are for Israel. God made a covenant and said, these are my appointed feasts. With these people, with you, these are symbols of the Old Testament covenant. And there are shadows and types of what we have fulfilled in Christ. Hallelujah. Christ is our Passover lamb. He is the first fruit from among the dead. You know, the Holy Spirit was given on Pentecost. And the fall feast will also be fulfilled in Christ. But anyway, brothers and sisters, let me get back to my original message before I went on those rabbit trails. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Anyway, I just wanted to give that information about the head of the year, because lots of Christians want to try to do Old Testament stuff instead of celebrating the very thing, the very which is Christ in the gospel. They want to celebrate the shadow and of things to come, as it tells us in Hebrews. Those things in the Old Testament are shadows of things to come, as it is mentioned. Jesus is the Passover lamb that takes away the sins of the world. He fulfilled that. He fulfilled the Feast of First Fruits by resurrecting on that day. He fulfilled what Jonah did. Just as Jonah was in the belly of the whale 3 days and three nights, so was the Son of Man in the belly of the earth for 3 days and three nights. He fulfilled those things. But anyway, brothers and sisters, if you want to try to live as a Jew, as a Messianic Jew, and you feel the Lord is leading you to do that, then, you know, let's go all the way back and let's do it right. Don't follow the Pharisees, because the Pharisees today is called Rabbinical Judaism. And they're the ones who are coming up with all these extra biblical stuff, like saying Rosh Hashanah is in the seventh month, Tishri, when it's actually supposed to be in the beginning of the year. And March is the real Rosh Hashanah. Just FYI, brothers and sisters, as the Lord has inspired me to go along here. Let's continue. This is why I don't do expository preaching. Expository preaching is when you take a chapter like I'm doing now and go verse by verse. That's why I don't do it. Even when you go to Bible school and you go to, you know, Bible college and seminary and all that, you learn how to do expository preaching. Most churches do expository preaching. But brothers and sisters, the Lord always leads me to go by subject. So that's why people say, oh, Brother Patrick, you're flowing in a stream of consciousness. Because my ministry is prophetic. I do flow in a stream of consciousness as I hear from the Lord, because my ministry is prophetic. But I am following a theme, a thread, which is a topic that the Lord might give me, like faith. It all ties together. Or in this case, it's supposed to be about the crowns that we would have in heaven. Somehow it's all related. Well, it's all in the Bible, right, brothers and sisters? Praise God. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Let's see. Verse 6, 2 Timothy 4, verse 6. For I am ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. Hallelujah. Is our time of departure at hand? That's what I'm talking about, the rapture. But Paul was going to be executed. But our departure from this world is at hand. Listen, I fought the good fight. I finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all those that love his appearing. So the crown of righteousness for those who are longing and seeking and looking for our Lord to appear in the air so that he may catch us up. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, on way on up there in about 50, 51, 52 of that text also. Brothers and sisters, so the rapture is a time that no man knows the day or the hour. And we literally do not know. But as the Apostle Paul taught us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, which I was just talking about, the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we forever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. I lost my train of thought because the music has paused or stopped to change in songs. And it's getting me off track, brothers and sisters. The silence. See? It's hard to operate in silence. But anyway, brothers and sisters. So, the Lord could rapture his church tomorrow. It could be 6 months from now. It could be 5 years from now. We do not know, brothers and sisters. But the season is here. We are in that window, brothers and sisters. But a window with the day, with the Lord. It can be over several years, brothers and sisters. We don't know that. I hope and pray that it is now. I say that all the time, brothers and sisters. And I know people want to hear that it's going to be tomorrow. It could be. I pray that it would be today. Right now, in the next 5 minutes. But people could also leave this world by other means. You and I could leave this world by other means tonight. You know, our soul could be required of this night is one of the parables that Jesus tells. He said there's a guy that stored up his treasure and said, oh, my barns are filled and, you know, I'm all fat and happy. Everything's awesome. And the Lord said, you know, this man is a fool because even tonight his soul is required of him. So we don't know, you know, we don't know when our time to depart out of this world is. And hopefully, by the grace of God, everyone listening to this video, no one of you will die and none of you will miss a rapture, that you all be raptured and none of us will see death. That as Paul said again, you know, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, you know, that the prophecy would be fulfilled on that day that says, oh, death, where is thy sting? You know, grave, where is thy victory? You know, that, you know, the death is swallowed up in victory on that day of the rapture, the resurrection of the saints, brothers and sisters. Praise God for that day. But I was talking about crowns, and I mentioned them, but this is what I, you know, and everybody wants to hear about heaven. They want to hear about crowns. Verse 7. You know, and if you guys, you know, those of you who've been watching my videos, you know, even when I give the words like the Lord gave me a dream or a word from the Lord and all this stuff, I always turn it around and use it as an excuse to do what the Word of God says, that God endures the foolishness of preaching that some might get saved. You know, so when I do dreams and visions and words from the Lord, I always put it in the middle of preaching because it doesn't matter, you know. Like I say, I'm trying to say this in nice words. It doesn't matter how many dreams or visions or if the raptures, if the Lord himself came, appeared in this room and got on this video and said, the rapture is going to be tomorrow. What good is it if people aren't ready, rapture ready? And that's what I've been trying to tell you, those of you who know faithfully, you know, by the grace of God, feel led to watch these videos and be discipled by this ministry that God gave me. Praise God for the ministry that the Lord gave me, Joshua's ministry in the Philippines and here in YouTube, the Church of the Firstborn. I thank God for the ministry that he gave me to do, to bring glory to his name and honor to his name. Those of you guys who know me, the very people, the very ones who are running to and fro, the very ones that got set on fire just in the last months and since 2011 and just running to and fro trying to find out when the rapture is there. The very ones who fall away. The very ones I'm talking about that don't want to hear preaching. You know, all the time I get, you know, and I, like I say, when I talk about these kind of things, people say, it's not, I'm trying to give this as an example. As an example to all those who watch this video. All the time I get people say, well, can you just stop, you know, preaching and all that and just tell the dream you had? God didn't give me these dreams so people could take it and run with it. God gave dreams so that people and all those things that we can learn and be discipled and grow in him. And it would lead people to repent, lead people to sanctify themselves, lead for people to get ready to be rapture ready, to be ready to meet the Lord. Hallelujah. To be that bride without spot or blemish. To be, you know, free of wrinkles, as it said, that bride without spot or wrinkle. That's what the Lord wants to do, to prepare ourselves, to sanctify ourselves. It's not knowing when, but to always be ready. That's the commandment of the Lord, as he says. He says, always be ye ready, for you know not what hour the master comes. He comes as a thief in the night. You know not what hour he comes. No, you do not know. So that's why you want to look at Yom Teruah in the right way. It's also a shadow. See, Yom Teruah, the date, is a shadow of the Lord coming as a thief in the night. It doesn't necessarily say, oh, the Lord is pegged to come that day. It's saying this is how he's going to come. He's going to suddenly appear just like that new moon appears. And they're going to be, he's going to be descending with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. There's going to be a trumpet blown at that time. So Yom Teruah, of all that trumpet blowing they do, like 99 trumpet blows they do, which is their tradition. The Bible doesn't say how many trumpet blows to do. Go read in your Bible for the feast of Yom Teruah, the feast of trumpets. You will not see any details given about how many times a blow. That's all tradition. But anyhow, that's a type and a shadow and a symbol of what the Lord's going to do. Not the other way around. The rapture is not dictated by the Feast of Trumpets. The Feast of Trumpets is a shadow and a type and an earthly lowly image of the grand things God does in the sky. In other words, it's a parable in reverse. This is a thrown alongside. Parable means para, like a paramedic, a paralegal, is beside of, or a lesser type of. A paralegal is a minor, you know, a 10% example of what a lawyer is. You know, just knows some, a little bit, and works alongside of a lawyer. So a parabole, and bola is to throw. So a parabole is to throw alongside of. So the Old Testament feast, and this is what the Lord's given me. I didn't even think about it. Of course, you know, as I'm flowing in the stream of consciousness from the Spirit of the Lord. These are parables in reverse. The things that happen in the Old Testament are shadows of things that are fulfilled. The very thing is fulfilled. What we, the church, know, Israel is living in the shadow of things, in the parables, the reverse parables, where we are living. If you're a born-again Christian, we are living in the very thing. For the word, you know, the letter of the law brings death, of the word brings death. But the spirit of the law gives life. Hallelujah. It's the spirit. Let me give you an example, as the Holy Spirit has just given me an example. As Jesus quoting from the Ten Commandments, you've heard it's been said, thou shalt not commit adultery, the letter of the law. Don't have sex with anybody that you're not married to. Okay, check. But Jesus said, but I say unto you, if you look on someone in lust, you've committed adultery already in your heart. See, the spirit, higher standard, way higher, way higher. Under the law, the people were required to give a tenth of everything they had, a tithe. In the New Testament, it says God loves a cheerful giver. The spirit of the law, the thoughts and intents of your heart. Brothers and sisters, what Paul says, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. So ask yourself, can you say that? Read that Bible verse and say, hey, am I rapture ready? How do I know if I'm rapture ready? Let's look at this Bible verse. You know, people are always asking how to be rapture ready. Luke 21:36, where Jesus says, when he's talking about the tribulation, he said, watch therefore and pray always that you are found worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Watch all and pray always that you will be worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. All these things come with the tribulation. So people ask all the time. And then I've done videos where I showed you where the Lord Jesus, when he wrote in Revelation 2 and 3, he said, to he who overcomes will I give this crown of life. To be an overcomer. How do we overcome him? It's talking about the tribulation saints specifically. By the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. That's how they overcome. They don't take the mark. They don't deny the Lord. They overcome during the tribulation. That's how they get that crown of life, because they're going to be martyred. The Revelation says, I think it's in chapter 20, it says, I saw those whose heads were, you know, their heads are chopped off, beheaded, for not taking the mark and not denying the Lord, for the word of their testimony and the blood of Jesus. They get that crown of life. But for you and I, brothers and sisters, do you want to know if you're rapture ready? And I say these other verses all the time. Romans chapter 8, verse 14 to 16. Verse 14. Those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Verse 16. Because it talks about the creation is groaning in travail that the sons of God would be revealed. It's talking about the rapture, the resurrection of the saints, those people that are dead in Christ to come up out of the earth. Those gravestones are going to bust open. Just like Jesus when he was resurrected, the gravestone rolled away. Those graves is going to open up for all those other people resurrected. Some people say, oh, the grave doesn't need to open. Yeah, it opened up for Jesus. If it didn't need to open up for Jesus, it opened up for Jesus. It needs to open up for all the resurrected saints. All their graves will come open. So that's the creation in travail, because all those bones, all the dust from those bodies is in the ground. Millions of people who are saints who have gone on, who are dead in Christ, are already there in heaven, in spirit body. They're going to descend with the Lord and meet and come down here and get their earthly body. They'll rise first, and then we'll be caught up to meet them in the air with the Lord. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, 17, and 18, that I always quote. So Romans 8, verse 14, same chapter where those are the sons of God to be revealed. Those who will be resurrected. Those are going in the rapture. Those who are led by the Spirit, Paul said, these are the sons of God. Are you led by the Spirit? That's what makes you a child of God in the real text. It doesn't say the masculine word. It's children of God, child of God. Then verse 16, Romans 8, verse 16. His Spirit will bear witness with your spirit that you are a child of God. Does his spirit, does you know in your spirit, not because someone said, oh, you said the sinner's prayer, and I say by the authority of the word of God, you're saved. No, even though that's part of it. But his spirit bears witness with your spirit that you're a child of God. In other words, you know that you know that you know in your heart that you're a child of God. Nobody can tell you that you are not a child of God, because you know in your heart you're a child of God by the Spirit of God bearing witness to you. I started to say, do you understand in different languages? I don't know why that came to me, you know, Cavicious, Italian, and all these different languages. I was going to use Filipino, but there's not too many people watching that would know that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, in German too, but let's see. So can you say that, brothers and sisters? Can you say, I have fought a good fight? I finished my course. The race God gave you to run, not the race God gave anybody else to run. Every one of us has our own race to run. And sometimes that means to be a cook at a homeless shelter. Sometimes that means that God wants us to give out 1,000 New Testaments to people on the street. You know, like the Gideons do, giving Bibles at schools and stuff or whatever. Maybe the Lord wants you to go visit people in prison. When I was in prison, you visited me. When I was naked, you clothed me. Matthew chapter 25. The sheep and the goats separated by the Lord at the judgment of those people here on earth. Not the church, that's the tribulation saints and all those guys. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was poor, when I was hungry, you fed me. That's the course that God has called us to do different things. We all can't do all of those things, but we all have different callings. Some people are called to prison ministry. You know, some people are called to be missionaries in the Philippines. I have kept the faith. Have you kept the faith? Have you kept the faith? I mentioned this in the video the other day that I was referring to earlier, way back in this video. When the night before Jesus was betrayed at the Last Supper, you know, Peter said, you know, Lord, I'll never leave you. I'll be there with you. And then Jesus said, oh, you know, before the crow, the cock crows 3 times, you'll deny me 3 times. You know, you'll deny me thrice. King James says 3 times. And then, you know, in one of the Gospels, I think it's Luke, you know, Jesus says to Peter, Simon, Simon, Satan wishes to sift you like wheat, but I prayed for thee, you know, that you would not lose your faith, that you would keep the faith, and when you're restored, strengthen the brethren. So what the Lord prayed, as I mentioned in the video a week or two ago, Jesus did not pray that Satan would leave Peter alone. Jesus did not pray that Peter was going to be, you know, perfect and all those things. He said, I pray that you keep the faith, that you not lose your faith. And that's why Paul says right here in this text, I have fought a good fight. You know, a good fight. He didn't say, you know, you didn't have some bad days. You know, the devil didn't beat you some days, or your flesh didn't beat you some days. You repent and go on. See, that's where all these Judaizers come in, and then the greasy gracers come in. Listen to me. I'm not a greasy gracer saying you can say the sinner's prayer one time and live like hell and go to heaven. And I'm not saying you have to follow the law and be a Judaizer and of the circumcision and be perfect or think you're perfect in self-righteous arrogance and go to heaven. I'm saying that the Lord calls us to, it's just so simple. He's called us to fight a good fight. Give your best effort and the grace of God will do the rest. Give your best effort, repent of your mistakes, and God will do the rest. I have finished my course. Finish the race that God called you to. As Paul talks about, there's a crown laid for me, you know, for finishing the race. You know, he talked about like the Olympics, running a race. That's why we're surrounded by many cloud of witnesses. That's Hebrews chapter 12. And then he said, I have kept the faith. So you have to do the best you can to fight the good fight against the world, the flesh, and the devil. To fight the good fight. You need to finish the race that God gave you to do the best you can. That's part of fighting a good fight. Paul finished his course. Most people don't finish their course. But you have to do your very best. God knows. That's what people, you know, that's the problem with, like I said, with the Judaizers trying to be perfect and the greasy gracers. What they don't understand is God can divide, as it says, the word of God, Hebrews 4:12, is quick and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, you know, dividing asunder even the bone and the marrow, you know, the marrow from your bone and all that. And, you know, dividing the thoughts and intents of the heart. God knows your attitude. He knows whether you're willfully sinning. He knows whether you're going to repent when he starts lighting a fire under your behind. As the Bible says, he chastens those whom he loves. That's also from Hebrews. I think Hebrews chapter 4. I can't remember. But the Lord chastens whom he loves. I may be way off on that. It's in Hebrews. I forget what chapter. The Lord chastens whom he loves. As you know, if you have children, you don't spank them. You don't discipline them. Well, you don't love your kids, the Bible says, which is true. You know, spare the rod and spoil the child. So the Lord spoils us a little bit, and then sometimes we need a good whacking to get back in line. I have kept the faith. And that's where simple childlike faith comes in. That's why the Lord said to the Church of Philadelphia, which most people think is the, you know, the evangelicals, like your Baptists and all those type of people, because, you know, all those scholars had divided those timetables up for the different churches. You know, and what did the Lord say to them? Well, he said one thing. He said, well, you haven't denied my name. They've kept the faith. That's about it. They didn't really do anything great, and they didn't really do anything bad, but they kept the faith. They did not deny the Lord's name. So that's ultimately what it pins down to. It always comes back to your faith. That's why when people who are trying to do sanctification and trying to live righteously in the holiness movement and the Pentecostal movement, when you deal with people like that, there are lots of people who are fearful. As it says in Revelation, the fearful cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Fearful, you know, fear is the opposite of faith. Faith and belief, the opposite of faith and belief, you know, and belief is fear and unbelief. And so, you know, the Lord, what does it say? Listen to me. First, you know, that's why grace is so important to teach. Because people tell, you know, people that don't have an ear to hear this, and well, you're preaching, you know, you're like preaching like grace, and then you're preaching that, not preaching works. I'm preaching that as exactly what Paul said in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. It says, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. In that same chapter, a few verses later, Paul says, we're not saved by works, but we're saved unto do good works. James, a half-brother of Jesus, tells us, show me your faith without works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Don't you know, O vain man, faith without works is dead. Faith without works is dead. You know, you're supposed to bear fruit. The Lord rejected Israel and brought the Gentiles because they bore no fruit. It's like he cursed the fig tree. Why? Because it didn't bear any fruit. That was a parable. Jesus was doing something metaphoric in a parable. He cursed the fig tree. May you never bear fruit again. Because Israel was bearing no fruit. He was going into Jerusalem in those days. That was during his Passion Week, declaring that you guys are bearing no fruit. You haven't done what God called you to do. You make other people twice the child of hell as you are when you get one convert. You know, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees. Go read these things. Matthew chapter 21, 22, 23. Those places in there, you'll see these things. Brothers and sisters, as I said, it's just so simple. But I'll see if I need to repeat some things here, because I had lots of different ways I could lay this out to you again. Many of you who understand won't praise God. There are some people that are new and maybe don't know these things. We are saved by grace through faith. So keep the faith. As it says in Hebrews chapter 11, that's what else I was going to mention, verse 6 and 7, long in there. It says, without grace, without faith, it's impossible to please God. And he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So how do we acquire anything from God? Salvation, physical healing, to be raptured. Everything is acquired by faith. Our part is faith. By grace are you saved through faith. And then some of these old denominational people will try to change the meaning, but some people, experts who know the Greek, will say, no, they're wrong. But this is what they'll say. It says, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, a gift of God. They'll say that the faith is a gift of God. You know, the faith, the act of faith. But in the Greek, the scholars say that it's talking about the grace. And that makes sense. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. The grace is from God. Now, the Bible says, to every man is dealt the measure of faith. So we've all been given faith. Non-believers have a measure of faith in them. They just don't exercise the faith that God gave them. It's just like any gift. You know, God could give you the gift of interpretation of tongues. But if you go into a church and then someone speaks in tongues and then you hear the interpretation, but you don't say it, you don't exercise it, you refuse to listen and obey. Well, you had the gift, but you didn't exercise it. So God has given every man, to every human on earth, the gift of faith. But all those millions of people that die every day in this world without salvation have rejected that measure of faith that God gave them. It was a free gift. They didn't exercise their free will in faith. You want to be raptured? Do those three things. Do the best you can to fight against the world, you know, death, hell, and the world, the flesh, and the devil. The things of this world, go look that up. Your own flesh, sin, and then the devil, which, you know, try to attack you and all this kind of stuff. Spiritual warfare. Do your best to finish the race that God called you to do, whatever your calling is. Build orphanages, as I said. Go, you know, do street evangelism. You know, be a mighty businessman or woman and donate money to missionaries or to buy Bibles and give them away, etc., etc., etc. Go visit people in prison, etc. And keep the faith. Keep the faith in Christ, the finished work of Christ. Keep your faith in the finished work of Christ. Not what you've done, but what He's done. And I keep hearing from the Lord the word crown of glory. Crown of glory. Hallelujah. I forgot which one that is, but I keep hearing it in my ear. Let's worship Him, brothers and sisters, for a minute. I've already been going for one of my, what is that? My marathon videos. But when I start hearing these things, brothers and sisters, and I start hearing, feeling the anointing of God on one of these songs, I can't help but worship the Lord. What a friend we have in Jesus. Let's worship Him for a minute. Let's go for 40 minutes. Oh, yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Everything to God in prayer. See, if you don't care to God in prayer by faith, you're suffering for no reason. That's what this song is saying. All what peace we often forfeit. We forfeit peace. What needless pain we bear. What needless pain we carry, we bear. All because we do not carry. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord, we should carry it. Everything to God in prayer. Hallelujah. Carry it to hear the Lord in prayer. Friend, we have it, Jesus. Allah. Thank you, Lord. What a privilege to carry. I'm getting myself. I'm tired, brothers and sisters. What a privilege to carry. Everything to God in prayer. It's a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Hallelujah. Don't forfeit your peace. Give it to the Lord. Don't bear the pain. Roll it on Jesus. Hallelujah. Give it to the Lord. Carry it to the Lord in prayer. Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, I want to tell you something. God loves each and every one of you. The Lord wants me to tell you that He loves each and every one of His children. And He beareth our sickness and our diseases. He beareth our infirmities upon Himself. The Lord takes delight in His people, and He loves His people. I just see, you know, I'm not talking because I see the Lord with His talik, His prayer shawl, and I see the Lord just walking amongst His people and the people touching Him of His garment. I just saw it while I'm sitting here looking. You know, there's an old gospel song. I don't know how old it is, but I heard it before in an old country church in the mountains of North Carolina here. It's called, He's Still Passing By. He's still passing by like the woman with the issue of blood. The Lord Jesus is still passing by. His people cry out to Him. I got lots of more videos to make. The Lord's given me 100 messages. I haven't made the videos because I've been trying to study the thing, trying to keep up with what He showed me, brothers and sisters. By His grace, I have time to keep making videos. Love you guys. God bless you in the Lord Jesus Christ. May the peace of the Lord God be upon you. May it give you rest and peace and joy in Jesus' name. God bless you all, brothers and sisters. Love you all in Jesus' name.